tested a lot for this.
Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Cons of Tarkir. We're in Hawaii. Marshall Seckliff in the booth with Zach Hill. We've got Dave Williams. Chatting with one of his best friends here.
Hope you go.
Paul Rietzl, that's who he's playing against, and they are playing to be 3-0 in their pod. And let's listen in on their conversation as we give them the cue to go ahead and start fighting.
No more messing around. No more not caring.
Yes.
All right. Most common life total, 21.
Says that's his most common life total, sitting at 21. And Dave Williams, you know, I bumped into him out in the hall.
Go.
And he's a buddy of mine, and I said, hey, how's your deck? And he's like, I'm not that happy with it. He said it just went okay. He said, if I get a 2-1 out of it, I'll be pretty happy. But, you know, after rattling off 2 wins in a row, he's got to be pretty excited to try to get a 3-0 out of this deck.
I mean, he's got the card that I didn't see when I went through the deck list the first time is Ghostfire Blade.
Yes.
It's one of the most powerful cards in the format. He's got a lot of morphs, so being able to move that blade around for just a single mana makes combat a nightmare for your opponent.
I asked him how highly he took that when I came across that card while thumbing through the list, and he said first. It was second, yeah. Pack 2, pick 1.
Can imagine that.
Dave deciding what to play on turn 3. Often we'll just see a morph here. And that's what we see here this time as well.
Making sure it's the right morph that he wanted to put down. On Rietzl's side, that Ice Feather Aven that we saw do such good work last match there, along with Arc Lightning, powerful spell for, you know, a decade and a half.
Mm-hmm.
And Bloodfire Expert, a 3-1 that can get a little bit bigger. Arc Lightning, I was just going to say, a little bit worse in this format than it has been in other ones. Just not that many one toughness creatures going around. Expert, one of the few that you're really willing to play, even if it's not all that exciting, but it can do a lot of damage in a hurry.
It certainly can. You need to be able to clear the way for it, but if you can, big chunks of damage come off of the life total. It also trades nicely on defense.
Oh, yeah.
All right, Dave, so let's see what you've got here. He's got an Efreet Weapon Master in his hand, a Glacial Stalker face down on the battlefield. He's got an Anok Tracker. And Rietzl just snaps off the block. Can't block fast enough.
The next one gets second. Like, is this counter discarded forever?
Yeah.
Oh, I guess that's why they need 20. Glacial Stalker.
You see Rietzl making a quick note of the morphs that that he's now seen from David Williams. So Glacial Stalker is the first one to add to that list. And here's another one that he will see eventually, one way or another.
So we see the Anok Bondkin in Williams' hand. That's actually one of the ways to allow Rietzl to get a 2-for-1 with Arc Lightning. So Rietzl probably just going to play Ice Feather Aven here and not spend 3 mana to deal with a morph straight up. Maybe he is. I guess he's thinking there. He's like, okay, I can deal with this morph before Williams gets 5 mana to unmorph it.
So that's pretty nice for Dave Williams, because he could have easily had a plan turned out next turn where he was going to play a Morph and an Anok kind of got destroyed. So he's happy about that. That could have got ugly. But he actually doesn't have the next land anyway, but another Morph hits the battlefield. And you can see here, Zach, what you mentioned earlier. If he has the equipment, right? If he had that here, this whole entire game would be totally different, but it's not.
Cards.
All right, here's a Mystic of the Hidden Way. Cast the hard way.
Looking to be one of the first creatures able to survive for very long on this battlefield.
Mm-hmm. Dave has Defiant Strike, Force Away, a War-Named Aspirant. He would love to get that active, and then still has that Efreet Weapon Master in his hand. He's drawn an island here as well. He's going to crash into the red zone. No trade for Rietzl. He wants to protect his 3-2 unblockable.
Oh.
And there's War-Named Aspirant. Yeah, and that's going to pick up a counter. And follow up with a second morph here. So Rietzl's still got a Snowhorn Rider and an Ice Feather Aven in his hand.
You can just attack and play that Snowhorn Rider and say, like, okay, how are you going to deal with a 5-5 trample?
That is something that you see that doesn't come up as often as I thought it would, which is just slamming those morphs on 6 for their full amount and not messing around with getting cute, just like, here, deal with this thing.
He's also got Set Adrift. Once any of those morphs turn face up, you can deal with those. Aven can bounce them. I mean, I feel like if Rietzl ends up winning this game, he's going to deal like 12 or 15 damage just with that Mystic of the Hidden Way, just playing tempo spells to stay alive for a little bit longer. Ifrit Weapon Master does complicate things, because you know that that's one of the premier reasons to be in Jeskai, and that means that playing Snowhorn Rider against a board of two morphs is actually kind of problematic, because it just, you know, is going to trade with a 2-2.
Hey, doing doesn't it the good old fashioned. Rietzl's now played two morphs back to back, neither of them face down.
We see a Defiant Strike, Force of Way for Williams. Force of Way could give him an entire turn to attack uncontested, but I might just do that with the abilities of his morphs. Basically just saying, okay, I dare you to block.
And Paul Rietzl takes that dare, snaps off the third morph that Rietzl had played.
Saying, okay, Weapon Master is going to happen.
Weapon Master, target this thing, and Rietzl hates that outcome.
If he'd have blocked the Weapon Master, that would have probably forced Williams to use Force Away.
Yes. He also has Defiant Strike that he could use the 2 for 1 himself.
Right.
Actually, that would have worked out fine anyway.
Oh, no, that's right.
First strike.
Yeah, because he has 1 extra mana for 5 power first strike. That actually would have been even better for Williams. Right.
So Rietzl actually picked correctly, even though it didn't work out the way he was hoping. Set Adrift, but oh, he's got the big one there. Do you see that?
The
Unwritten, Zach.
That is a good way to get back into a game.
See the Unwritten is one of the cooler Mythic Rares from this set. I had a chance to play it at the pre-release, and it was impressive every time.
It basically allows you to look at 8 cards, and if you've attacked this turn, to get 2 creatures. But interestingly, he's only going to get 1 creature with it, not having attacked with Mystic.
It's Ferocious.
Oh, it's Ferocious.
Yeah,
oh, gotcha.
So
I thought
it
was not read.
So what does he find? Another Snowhorn.
Well, it's still pretty good.
Not too bad. And if he's got another blue mana source here, he could set Adrift as well if he wants. And I think he might have that.
14.
Yes, he is going to set Adrift as well. The War-Named Aspirant.
Because you don't really want to reset your opponent's Ifrit Weapon Master.
No.
You don't have to.
But now all of a sudden, Paul Rietzl finds himself in what looks to be a very favorable situation with a 5-5 versus a 4-3 first strike. Unfortunately, for Paul, Dave does have the combat trick he needs to get through. The question now becomes, even if it does get through, does Paul care? Like, does Paul just say, sure, take 4 or take 5 or whatever, but I'm going to hit you for 8 and then 8 and you're going to be dead.
I love blocking, too. That's a sick thing. That's the really sick part.
Yeah, this is a sick spot.
Because Paul has to know, given Williams' attack last turn, that Williams would have been okay.
Yeah, 2 cards
with
I don't
the
know about?
3. I don't know if he forgot something. I don't know.
So Paul's conundrum here is that the idea is Dave knows that Paul's not going to block anyway. So he will attack no matter what. But he actually has the combat trick he needs to get through. So Paul's deciding if it's greedy, if he wants to go for the block. Because it's so obvious that Dave needed to attack anyway.
You can't block and you want to just... Oh, God. Pure magic. This is so pure.
It really is. It really is. This is a great spot.
I don't know if I can respect myself if I take it. All right, I'm going to block.
Oh, my goodness.
And Dave
Williams
goodness. Gets him.
Yep.
Defiant Strike. He said, I couldn't respect myself if I didn't. Because it was so obvious for Dave Williams to attack there. It was the only reasonable thing that he could do.
Yeah.
But he also had it.
Yeah.
It's a pretty nice spot to be in.
That's
because he wasn't going to be able to block anyway.
Well, I mean, right. I mean, that's the thing. If you can't block, I mean, when can you block? The answer is probably not ever. That said, getting hit with Divine Strike is, I think, the worst possible thing in the format for Rietzl.
Right, and that, of course, turns on Warning Aspirant again, so he gets the counter on that, and he gets to play an Enoch Bonkin, which is going to make that Warning Aspirant have first strike on top of all of the other bad things that happened to Paul Rietzl that turn. So Rietzl's at 12.
Go.
And a morph is what Paul can come up with here.
Okay.
I'm assuming that's the Ice Feather Aven.
Yes.
Is that right, Zach? Yeah. Okay.
And we got Smite the Monstrous from Dave. Not really any targets right now.
Yeah, a little late for that. After a pair of Snowhorn Riders, he kind of worked through those the hard way. Found the Smite a little late, but so it goes.
And still got Force Away if Rietzl is able to provide a blocker. I mean, we've seen in the feature match area, Ifrit Weapon Master just take over games.
We
it
have.
Seems like there's almost never any good way to deal with it.
Yeah, I think that Williams is doing the math right now on just being aggressive with his Force Away or trying to get tricky with it, because he can just Force Away the morph and just say, Paul, just take a ton of damage here. 4, 5, 6, 7. And it looks like the Anok Bonkin did not battle.
Williams basically saying, okay, there's a lot that goes wrong if my opponent flips a morph.
Yeah, the thing that he's really considering, though, is that Paul doesn't have 5 mana. So there's
right.
very few things that he can turn over, and none of them actually tussle with what he's got.
Well, the thing is that both Monastery Flock and a 1/1 regenerator allows you to open, block and regenerate. Like, there's a lot
to
of the
change
morphs.
The race.
Yeah, well, to change. Yes. There's a lot more that can actively, profitably deal with a 2/1 than with a 2/2 in the format. So I think he's just like, okay.
All right, and this is a huge play for Rietzl, because the Ice Feather Aven's going to bounce the Anok Bonkin, taking First Strike away from the Warname Aspirant and enabling a trade here. So this is actually a big swing as well. And Paul has set himself up pretty decently, but Dave, remember, is not out of tricks yet. So he's trying to decide if he wants to use that Force Away maybe to save his Warname Aspirant. I mean, bouncing the Aven isn't great.
No.
And they are just trading, so it's not the end of the world anyway. And remember, Paul does take 4, dropping down to 8 off of that transaction. So overall, Dave says, okay, you got me. That's fine. No problem. He can also just immediately replay his Anok Bonkin. And that's exactly what he does. Ships turn back. So staying slightly ahead of the curve here is Williams, who's got Paul Rietzl down to 8. Dave's on 11. 4 turns away from death here, but with plenty of room to work with. So,
8.
And you mentioned it earlier, Zach. You thought that Mystic of the Hidden Way was going to get in there for a bunch, and it certainly has.
Another 5/5.
And Rietzl can still survive an attack. Rietzl's counterattack with Mystic could get Williams all the way down to 5.
Here's Scion of Glaciers now for Paul Rietzl. Yeah.
That is pretty
good.
That's a
good blocker.
That is a very good blocker. And it gets around Smite the Monstrous despite having 5 toughness.
Yep, it does not get around Force Away, though.
That is true.
And Force Away loot is happening, and, Dave drew something better than Smite the Monstrous here, so I didn't see quite what it was, but he's got something he likes better. So he says 6 you and Arc Lightning you down to dead.
Wow.
Dave Williams, with a deck he was not that happy with, has now beat Paul Rietzl in their first game here, so looking pretty good. We'll be back right after these messages.
Outfit your Magic collection with the newest Khans of Tarkir accessories from Ultra Pro. You can see the full array of card sleeves, deck boxes, playmats, and portfolios of your favorite Magic artwork at ultrapro.com. Play Magic at a store near you every Friday. Earn Planeswalker points and battle against your friends in Friday Night Magic. October's FNM promo card is Fanatic of Xenagos. Visit wizards.com/FNM for more information.
And welcome back to the feature match area here in sunny Hawaii. Marshall Sutcliffe with Zach Hill bringing you a live look-in now of Alexander Hain versus Chris Fennell. Two of the top 25 players in the world battling it out here, trying to go 3-0 in their pod. Chris Fennell, noted limited expert. And Alexander Hain, notable winner of all Magic tournaments he enters. So pretty tough matchup here for Chris, but looks like they're both at 20.
It's absurd. People pass it. It's so absurd.
I think he's talking about Armament Core.
Armament Core is what he was saying.
Ridiculous it is.
He said, this car's absurd. People pass it. It's still absurd. I agree with him.
That he's not wrong.
Card is so powerful.
Very good.
No downside either. You can put the counters on it and just make a 6-6.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Hain back a little bit against the wall. We don't know what the morph is. Kieran's certainly not capable of handling what's on the board. Smite the monster says.
Not attacking?
Sure. Is that an Abzan battle priest?
No.
Is that a what is it?
It's a 1/5 flyer that also has a +1/+1 counter, so that's going to prevent the Alabaster Kieran from really getting any work done.
Makes sense. The dice sort of squarely in the middle of the art.
Yes. It's funny. When I first saw it, I thought the same. I thought it was a Horde Chief. All right, here's an Alpine Grizzly for Chris Fennell. Looks like he's got an Abzan Charm sitting in his hand. Yep. He's not going to use it yet, though.
Say Fennell is an Abzan Charm?
Believe so.
Only one green mana source, though, so he's kind of got to cast one spell at a time. Is that a 2/6 flyer?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of toughness in this format. I mean, whether it's like just a 2/8 Mastodon.
Ankle Shanker has joined the party. Now, all of a sudden, Hain can start attacking.
Oh, yeah.
Attack with all three. Trigger.
And that's exactly what he does. So his creatures are going to get first strike and death touch here, essentially making it impossible to tussle with them in combat. They can either be chump locked or Fennell can just take the damage. He decides for the latter.
Yeah, you look at Ankle Shanker, you're like 5 mana for a 2/2 haste. What can this possibly do? But it basically makes blocking a complete nightmare for your opponent.
Yeah, some people really love that card. I'm kind of in the middle because if you're on your back heels or getting beaten down, that is not the card that you want to draw.
Not really a card that's going to stabilize the game for you.
The 2/2 for 5 doesn't usually do that. But if you're ahead or even close to ahead, it will keep you there and can definitely finish the game for you in short order. Powerful card to be sure.
So Fennell
deep in the tank. Not a lot going on. It looks like he's in statue mode here. He hasn't moved. There he is.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, when your opponent casts Ankle Shanker and you don't have a removal spell for it, you've got to figure out how you can be the aggressor.
Yes.
Because certainly playing defense is not going to be profitable.
That would be my favorite.
So, I mean, Fennell just kind of tanking. I mean, yeah, he can crack back for 6.
All right, why don't we jump back over to our main feature match as Fennell decides, you know what, I'm not blocking anyway, so we're battling. So let's get back to Paul Rietzl versus Dave Williams here on our main feature match. Dave, again, wasn't super happy with his deck coming out of the draft, but has managed a 2-0 and is now up a game on Paul Rietzl. Hall of Famer Paul Rietzl here, looking to 3-0 his draft pot and get off to a killer start here.
Go.
No early plays for either player here. Just lands. Yeah, nothing.
Elsewhere, we're hearing Flock take game one over PT Theros finalist Pierre Dijon.
Okay.
Your turn.
And a face-down morph creature for Rietzl. Probably going to be one for Dave Williams as well. He's got a million of them in his deck.
You see, we brought out a bunch of morph tokens with numbers on them to keep track of just how many hit the battlefield over the course of a match.
It's not fair to play a player with your psychological caliber in a morph format. It's really not.
I think that is the last time I was able to do well was Onslaught Box.
Fortunately, I couldn't request another pairing. I don't have that kind of pull.
No, that's not how that works, Paul.
Do over.
Do over.
Oh, that would have been the best way to win. All right, you have a non-morph creature in your hand. Or maybe just a spell.
Yeah, it could have just been a spell. I sat down.
Some kind of calling them mind games is probably a little too much credit, but they're just sort of teasing each other.
I mean, that does show you just the kind of thinking that applies to the pro level.
It
you
is
know,
true.
And everyone's just kind of like meta thinking about what each other could be representing Good. Just by the amount of time it's taken for them to do something.
Yeah. Okay. Reveal, reveal. So Monastery Flock trades for Weapon Master.
Wow.
So Paul Rietzel's probably got to feel pretty good about that.
Yeah, can't argue with that.
And another morph for Rietzl. Draw a card here for Dave Williams, and let's see what he comes up with.
So he's got a Mardu Horde Chief he can't cast. He's got a War Name Aspirant without raid. He's got Ghostfire Blade.
Oh, he just drew his Ghostfire Blade.
Yeah.
Yep. Hello. Here's a morph. Now, his morphs are going to be a lot better than Paul Rietzel's morphs. I'd be surprised if he trades this one off, especially now that Rietzl has five mana. He's not really going to be able to block
right.
anyway. So Dave's just going to have to take the two here. Unless he has some type of six soul read on Paul.
I'll morph it.
Take five, 15.
Oh, wow.
Nice read there for Williams.
I know. I get it. I have to play face up, and it's weird, and it's... My deck is much better, though, so maybe I can win anyway.
Rietzl being air quotes
Judge
humble.
It's illegal to play my morphs face up because he knows anyway.
Well, that would be awkward because there's no way for him to tell whether or not it's got the face up status. Yeah. So it should be face down.
We can note it somehow.
I like how the judge gave him a real answer.
Yeah, right. That would be awkward. That's true.
All right. So Dave Williams lamenting the fact that he's stuck on three lands. He says, well, I got three lands. You've got a 5/5 trample. I think I like your chances a little better than mine at the moment. And Paul Rietzl agreed. Not a great spot to be in here.
Yeah, although he's got, I mean, Williams has Force Away, has Ghostfire Blade, and five power on the table.
Your turn.
Cards.
Wow.
Is that Water Whirl there for... Paul Rietzl as
that
well.
Is Water Whirl, and when Rietzl passes the turn, six mana open, five cards in hand, you gotta suspect something's up if you're Dave.
Yeah, totally. And Water Whirl is a kind of get ahead, stay ahead card of the format. It doesn't pop up that often, but when it does, it is just disgusting.
Interestingly, Rietzl letting Williams attack, so he's able to trigger raid if that ends up mattering, despite the Water Whirl.
It could. War Name Aspirant is a card that that Dave Williams is running.
He also has Mardu Horde Chief in his hand, Force Away Einok Bondkin, Mystic, and Einok Tracker.
Yeah, not a great hand here for so Dave. Far. I mean, he's got plenty of good spells, and he's got the Ghostfire Blade to make all of these morphs, you know, kind of excel. But the problem is he's just... behind. He just doesn't have the luxury of waiting around. He plays the Mardu Horde Chief to help bolster out his board a little bit here, but again, the Snowhorn Rider's just bigger than anything that Williams does over the course of like one turn.
Right.
Five.
I mean, yeah, you see the life total, 5, 10, 15. Suddenly Williams is staring down a lethal attack. He's going to have to put something in the way or finally use that Force Away.
Paul Rietzl has a dig through time and an arc lightning.
All the tech. One phase dig. Well, two cards left. Soon to be four.
So he gets to look at seven cards and keep the two best
the green
ones.
Card, seven or eight also. It's eight. The green card. You look at 15 cards if you play them both.
See a Winter Flame, Ice Feather, Aven.
Jeez, must Scion. Be nice.
Yeah.
Crippling Chill is actually just a great one here, too. He doesn't need much. Remember, Williams' plan right now is to try to get enough things to stack block onto the 5/5, so just getting one of those out of the way just makes it so that Williams falls further and further behind. These tempo plays are huge. Now, the thing that Paul's got to consider is Williams just hit white, right? And he saw him discard a Smite the Monstrous earlier. You'd think he would have fired it off, but still, you know, that is the card that Rietzl, because if his threat goes away, then the Crippling Chills and stuff get a lot worse.
And as does See the Unwritten, too, which would only get one card instead of two.
Oh, yeah. I was trying to mix them in, try to maybe have not know what one of my cards is in my hand for one of the turns.
Rietzl's funny.
Six.
Yep.
You see, Hain Defeat Fennel 2-0.
Just draw that.
Decisive.
Slam bagging.
This is pretty funny. Dave Williams just drew a land. We haven't seen it yet, but to gain him a life.
Right.
And that's huge.
Yeah.
It's absolutely huge here.
It's a whole another
literally
turn.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the question is for Williams, how early does he want to get that rider off the table? Does he want to play a morph equip Ghostfire Blade? Does he want to, you know, trigger Raid while he can? I mean, he's got a lot of options. Warname Aspirant and bounce your creature is not the end of the world, but it looks like he's going to try to go ahead and get that blade attached to something.
Yeah.
I'm going to block, he says. Now, Rietzl, of course, if he attacks and Williams falls to one, Williams is just dead to arc lightning.
Well, I think that's what Rietzl's doing. He's like, wait a minute, I might not actually give you a chance to do anything here if I can.
Right. He can crippling chill the 4/4 attack, and that means Williams has to block with everything to not die to arc lightning.
Another Snowhorn Rider. In the meantime, the one that's active gets into the red.
That will not be untapped. So should I go to one, or should I chumpy chump?
You have to block with a Horde Chief. Not a blocking with a token doesn't do it.
Can't be that long game anyway, so pretend you don't have it.
It's good to get an insight into how he's thinking.
Yeah.
He's talking about what cards he can play around and which cards he can't. Sometimes people play around cards that they can't beat anyway.
Right.
And he's making sure he doesn't do that.
Cards three?
Four. Oh, five, I'm sorry, because I didn't show to replace itself.
Five, yeah. Because I'm not going to
untap. Dave in a super, super tough spot here. He's tapped out, doesn't have that Force Away mana available.
I have an arc light.
All right, and that's going to do it. Dave Williams says, you know, I can't beat an arc lighting anyway, so yeah, I'm not going to block, and,
right.
And Paul
just
had it.
In real fast, then I can get game three that way.
All right, so we're going to even things up here. Paul Rietzl makes a Snowhorn Rider.
What?
Right on time, and rides it all the way to victory.
He reads every single morph out loud when I play it, and he's been right every time.
That's what I do for a living, bro.
It's not fair in the morph format, you know what I mean? And he had two attacks in game one he chump attacked, and I took it. And then the second one, he had it, and I blocked.
All right, why don't we do a quick live look-in while our players are getting sideboarded. Looks like we've got Patrick Chapin versus J.D. Klomparens.
I'll leave this board state to you, Marshall.
What? Oh, jeez. All right, so a lot of lands for Chapin and nothing else, maybe? What is that over on the side? That's also a land.
Oh, we saw a Crater's Claws, I think, get cast last turn, because I noticed
right.
Chapin tapped out the claws in the graveyard.
You are correct. But Jadeen lands in front, and she pumps, it looks like, the Scion of Glaciers there, and Chapin says, yeah, we're done here. So that game ends pretty quickly. And we're gonna get a game three there, along with the game three on our main feature match. So we've got a lot of action here. Still have Chris Fennell and Alexander Hain. It looks like they're doing a little post-match chat, perhaps, as one of them has their whole deck laid out and the other one has a deck in their hand. So let's take a look at Yvonne Flock versus Pierre Dagen. And, well, I see a really nice one there with Mantis Rider. There's also Jeskai Wind Scout and a Morph for Pierre. What does Yvonne have? Oh. Sultai Flare, I love that card, Zach. The 3/4.
Yeah, Sultai Flare, very, very good. It means when anything big dies, including itself, you're going to gain 4 life. I mean, I feel like just every round we're watching a teamer deck. Seems to be a weapon of choice for a lot of the pros today.
9.
So Flock at 9. It's just a few attacks from the flyer. Jean at 12.
Yeah, now Sultai Flare can change that math.
Yeah.
if it or another 4 toughness creature were to die.
And And yet again, I mean, the potential for Ifrit Weapon Master makes blocking just a nightmare for Flock. Oh, well.
Manus Rider back.
That Manus Rider no attacks? Was that a... Oh, I think Flock dealt with it in combat.
Yeah,
okay.
It was second main.
Yeah.
Another funny sleeve choice. They're opposite.
That's awesome.
One of them's on Sultai, but Flock's actually playing Teemer. And he's got the Jeskai sleeves playing against Jeskai, so... So, Flock, this is his first Pro Tour after having won one. It's got to feel a lot different. Did you get to play any PTs after you top eighted?
I unfortunately did not.
You didn't. You went right in.
Went right into Wizards of the Coast, and I have not been nearly as good at Magic since then. And you're sitting there not only... Well, I appreciate that.
All right, why don't we jump back over to our main feature match, Dave Williams versus Paul Rietzl. We're getting to Game 3 here. And these matches down in the feature match area today for the draft portion have been fantastic. This set is producing some really great games.
All right, so this is the decisive game here, deciding factor game 3. Williams able to be on the play. Got to think that matters a lot
in
that matchup.
It has to matter a lot because, like, the last game we saw versus these two was pretty straightforward. Yep. It wasn't quite as swingy as some of the other games that we've seen. But Snowhorn Rider's a good one, it turns out, and... Rietzl just needed to back it up with a couple of bounce spells, and that was it.
I think we saw Williams fan his hand out. He had to read his own Jeskai charm. That card kind of does everything.
That was a lot of text.
Yeah.
So Williams has Aerostorm, Jeskai Storm, and a Glacial Stalker.
Go.
Decent little hand, and Rietzl's got a pair of islands and nothing on turn two. There's all three colors for Dave Williams, so that's good, and it looks like he's going to play that Glacial Stalker here. So Dig Through Time, See the Unwritten, Ice Feather Aven, and Snowhorn Rider. A powerful hand here for Rietzl, who also, even though he's played two islands, actually has enough to cast all of it.
Right.
Two and one.
Yep.
And he has drawn an Arc Lightning for the turn. He's going to take down the Stalker while he still can.
Williams 19, Rietzl 20.
And drop Dave Williams down to 19 in the process. Tranquil Cove for Dave Williams is going to put him back up to 20, though.
And just, it doesn't look like Williams has a way to develop his board.
He doesn't.
So.
Another Snowhorn Rider there for Paul Rietzl off the top of his deck. But the question is, who can make the first move here, right? Who can put out a threat that must be dealt with?
We see that Dig Through Time in Rietzl's hand. That means that the longer the game goes, in all likelihood, the better it is for Rietzl. Because eventually he's just going to be able to cast that, get two of the best threats in his deck, and overwhelm Williams with just raw card advantage.
Yeah. So Rietzl starts things off with a morph here. I'm assuming it's the Snowhorn Rider.
See Williams draw Ghostfire Blade. One of the best cards in his deck, but not really accomplishing a whole lot without anything on the board.
But it certainly could be a big player. I mean, so many of his creatures have morph. Then he could draw it at any time.
So that's probably a 05 wall bird.
Just reading everything out loud.
Go.
And there's Ghostfire Blade, and he passes the turn back.
And that's interesting because maybe Williams saying that he's guessing the morph wrong could incent Rietzl to flip it up because Rietzl thinks that Williams thinks that it's something else,
right,
which would be great for Williams' Jeskai charm.
Yeah.
Also, maybe not.
But also, Rietzl just isn't falling for any of that nonsense.
Right.
He's got better things to do with his mana here. And Dave Williams is not correct on this case. It's not the Monastery Flock.
Well, he might just be... representing that he doesn't know what it is since he's been calling them out every single turn of the game.
Totally.
If it doesn't resolve, does third wait for the next one? Yeah, it's fine.
Go.
All
a lot of things that Williams can do. He can arrow storm one of the morphs. Probably not going to force away it. Can leave men open for Jeskai Charm. Feat of Resistance, another great card, but like Ghost Fire Blade, just not a lot to do with it. And interestingly, for Rietzl's side, he could have hard cast the Ice Feather even, but just did not do so.
Drop some air water. Just, I want to keep my mouth on it.
Very important to stay hydrated in the Pro Tour.
I guess it is a nice thing about being in the feature match against one of your best friends. Is, you can ask him for a sip of water.
Williams, I just think trying to figure out which answer to use on which morph. He's trying to think about which morph is which based on the information Rietzl is able to reveal.
Yeah, he's deep in the tank. He ended up just playing a land and saying go, though. So
attack.
Yep.
Rietzl's going to battle with both of his morphs, which are both Snowhorn Riders.
I don't know what that. I can't, last, I can't last match, they played like a 6-6 yeah. six that doesn't have. I have no effects.
Talking about Ciroc.
Right.
Last time I ran into something huge.
Oh, man. One of the four Jeskai Elders.
Jeskai Elder now for Paul Rietzl. So he's just sort of patiently building out his board. Now he's got Ice Feather Aven to join the crew here, and he's got the Jeskai Elder. And Dave Williams is just falling further and further behind. He's just unable to find any gas here.
Mm-hmm.
Draws his card for the turn, so that whole turn last time culminated with him playing a land and not being able to do anything.
I don't know if I
could
take it.
What, if I had that card?
If you didn't cast it the last turn or whatever and you just were just waiting for me to overcommit, I'd be...
Talking about end hostilities here.
Well, that is interesting because, I mean, Williams didn't kill anything in the main phase.
No.
And then didn't cast an instant. I mean, that is a huge tempo loss for Williams.
Yeah. I mean... Paul Rietzl has to be wondering if he's just got all lands in his hand,
right.
You know. I mean, somehow Dave has managed to find no additional morphs for his Ghost Fire Blade. All right, so he called the Aven, and it was the Aven. Aerostorm takes it down. Though, unfortunately for Dave, I think that while the Aven's pretty good, I think he'd rather have taken down one of the Snowhorn Riders,
right.
But with two of them, it's kind of not that relevant.
Yep.
No buck.
He's going to flip one up now. There it is.
8, 2, 7.
And Dave Williams way up against it here. He's actually going to need something along the lines of a end hostilities to get himself out of this mess. His draw has just failed him here. He's got some decent cards, but no board presence.
Exactly. And Charm, you know, is only a temporary answer. Feat of Resistance, not going to do anything without a creature. I'm looking at his deck list. He does not actually have end hostilities.
Right.
So he is not drawing live on that particular out.
No, he's not.
Two and one.
All right, so Drew Arclightings, that deals with that. That's one of the Snowhorn Riders.
It is. That actually helps a lot. He still needs an answer, though. He can put the other one back on top of the library to sort of reset that whole chain. And only take one or maybe two damage next turn. And that's going to be during his upkeep so that Paul is forced to draw it.
And you have how many cards left? Three? Two?
I was thinking, I think, whether he wants to respond with Dig Through Time.
Possible. Right? So he bounces it on top of his library and then draws it. So that's you kind of saw Paul do that in one fell swoop.
Yep.
Going to get in there for one.
Or loot.
Loot. And there's another Snowhorn Rider. So, does Paul not have that land, though?
He doesn't have his sixth land, and
so
he doesn't have a second green for See the Unwritten.
So Paul actually can't just start slamming Snowhorn Riders
here
just face up. He gets rid of a Jeskai Elder.
I mean, the thing is, with See Through Time, Set Adrift... Or Dig Through Time, Set Adrift, See the Unwritten. I mean, he's got a crazy amount of gasoline in the tank.
Yes. Yeah, this is a tough spot for Dave because he's trying to just stay alive. Right. And meanwhile, Paul, while he can't quite deploy his threats in the manner that he would prefer, they also means that he's just got five of them in his hand.
Yep.
Now, he is able to, you know, he can cast, Williams can cast Feat of Resistance on Set Adrift, which means that Rietzl wouldn't have a particularly profitable attack this turn, although he can just unmorph Snowhorn Rider and not have to worry about any of that.
The Warname Aspirant is a 4-3 right now.
Exactly.
That's not big enough to tussle with the Snowhorn Rider, so Rietzl might just take that tack. Yeah, he's just like, heck with it.
I mean, if he unmorphs it tapping out, then Rietzl knows he's free to cast Feat of Resistance, which is actually a huge blowout.
You mean Dave, yeah.
Yep. Dave, right.
Sweet, there you go. Now you're in business, Dave Williams. He does still take a damage here, though. Goes down to 5. And Rietzl's back up to 20. And Dave Williams, he says it's a long climb back. How many cards you got? Rietzl says a lot. And he's even got more than it lets on because of that dig through time as well.
It is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yep, 15.
All right, so I mean, that's
five.
A lot of damage.
Williams, 5. Yep.
And here is an Anok Bonkin that's going to pick up that Ghost Fire Blade. Dave Williams kind of doing it the hard way by paying the full amount, but even then, it's a serviceable magic card, and it's keeping him in this game pretty nicely.
Now, Rietzl can attack for as many as 3 damage if he wants to, his Set Adrift dig through time. He can also cast Set Adrift for a single mana and cast Snowhorn Rider with the extra land that he has. That makes it harder to cast dig through time.
Yeah, I don't think he can do both Set Adrift and dig through time here, right?
Oh, right.
Yeah, but he can still...
He's close, but... I mean, yeah, just this. I think you want to get Snowhorn Rider on the battlefield. So this allows him to attack for 2, loot.
Yep.
And, you know, threaten lethal in a bunch of different ways next turn.
5. Cards left.
4.
Never good news for Dave Williams in this game. Every time he's asked how many cards he's had, it's been bad news.
Arc Lightning is gone.
So, and Williams trying to decide, I guess, if he wants to force away something.
Back for 2.
3.
Loot.
Williams.
Loot okay?
Yeah.
Dave Williams drops down to 3. Paul does find a land there.
Yeah.
He's got another one in his hand as well. This means Snowhorn Rider can be a thing, and there it is. Snowhorn Rider 5/5, and that is going to make stuff so difficult for Dave, who has fallen all the way down to 3. But it's really that dig through time. Remember, that's the Anok Bonkin that was sitting on top of Dave's library.
Yep,
your turn.
Which he replays.
Just brick out from here on out and have nothing.
So, yeah, ambitious ask for Dave.
I mean, I think he was just saying what he needs to happen to win the game. And as we know, Paul Rietzl's hand is actually just stacked up.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you can see the Unwritten for 2 creatures, do the Ferocious ability. He can dig through time to find a way to get the blocker out of the way.
And here's See the Unwritten. So, Dave, in order per your request... All right, so here's Force Away on Snowhorn Rider, though, which is going to make See the Unwritten not ferocious. And he's only going to get 1.
Wow, a lot of lands out of the way.
Wow, I think he did really... Did he get a Jeskai Elder only?
Yeah, that's all he's able to get.
Wow, so that could have been stage 1. I mean, he's still behind, but... That was about the idea... That I cannot imagine that there was a better way that could have turned out for Dave.
Yeah. I mean, he is. Dave's still at 3.
No,
so
I know.
Every threat very relevant.
Still, that had to be the best case.
Yeah, that's nuts.
Because Dave has 2 decent blockers here.
Right. I mean, Rietzl theoretically can attack for lethal by battling with both Jeskai Elders and casting Dig Through Time.
Well, but one of them has Summoning Sickness.
Well, I mean, yeah, next turn.
Dave attacks. Dave attacks and equips And ostensibly, Paul just needs to play two non-creature spells here.
Yeah, I think you just have to dig through time for an instant. Just hope that Dave doesn't have any. Smite the Monstrous isn't going to do it.
No.
You can also just recast Snowhorn Rider.
Not unreasonable.
Jesus.
Yep. That's what I was thinking.
Pretty
Dave.
Good.
It was awesome.
Paul just sifting through his deck. Yeah. In the last two turns, he's seen 15 cards from his deck and been able to do various things with those cards. So
that's Crippling Chill. He's got more threats if he needs them.
I mean, Crippling Chill would do it on its own if
right.
Dave doesn't have
right,
it.
Right.
Like, Water have a Whirl. Kill shot.
You just take Water Whirl land and get all of his cards off the battlefield. Which also is another non-creature. But, yeah, I mean, Crippling Chill is probably the most conservative play.
How many left did you count this?
Nah, I mean, five below the bottom, so.
Four, yeah, I'm just trying to.
Neither of us are living nine turns. Someone's dying.
I'm trying to kill you.
It's morbid from Dave.
Deck, well, you might have another.
You have two power creatures. It has to be right.
He's going to go for it. Paul's definitely going to just move in here.
Yeah. Setting up the bottom of his library properly.
Yeah. But he's like, look, it is just correct for me to go for the win right here.
Yeah. Like, even if Dave has kill shot or something. Oh, wow.
And Dave has nothing and has to pass it. Yeah. And that's going to do it. Paul Rietzl defeats Dave Williams 2-2. And improves to 3-0 in his pod, so a great start for both players.
I had like a handful of removal and balance. I was like, yeah, just give me a guy, please.
But Paul Rietzl's going to be one match better to start things off than his friend Dave Williams.
We also heard Flock take it 2-1 over Pierre Dejean, and Hain beating Fennell 2-0, so last match is Chapin Complarens.
That's the last one that we have going in our feature match area. But I just saw a handshake over there as well. And it looked like Chapin was the one offering the handshake, which signifies that maybe Jadeen has gotten by Patrick there for the victory. But we'll get a confirmation of that once we know for sure. Okay.
Chapin wins.
Chapin won 2-1. Yep. So Chapin improves 3-0 in his pod. So great stuff. That is actually going to do it as far as match action goes for the first section of the Pro Tour, the draft. And I got to say, Zach, that was fantastic stuff.
I mean, yeah, every single game is different. I mean, every single deck is different.
Yes.
Yeah, we've got four Jeskai Elder Delve Teemer. You know, Chapin, every single time we look over there, is casting Crater's Claws for 12 points of damage or something. It's like one of his constructed decks. Probably is his constructed deck.
I mean,
knowing Chapin.
I wouldn't be surprised to see Crater's Claws at all.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've seen a decent amount of that earlier, just a couple weeks ago, being fueled by Nick. I mean, it is a crazy format. This is some awesome magic.
Yeah, it's been great. And, of course, as we proceed through the rest of the day, we're going to be standards up next. And we've also got another draft tomorrow. So if you enjoyed this, make sure you come back tomorrow morning and watch the draft portion as well. And then, of course, more standard as well. We're grabbing maybe an interview down in the future match here. We'll see in just a second. But in the meantime, I have to say I had really high hopes for the format, and it delivered.
I mean, what I want to do is go draft. I guess we can't do it. We got a whole
everybody
gotta
at
work.
Home does too, right? We have work to do, but you can draft at home. You certainly have the ability to do that. What's your main takeaway, Zach, from the format as far as we saw a whole bunch of different methods, two color all the way up to full five color from Wesco. Where do you want to be?
I mean, I think that I still really like the solid, two-color aggressive deck backed with just, either some bombs of another color or a little bit of removal to push your way through. I mean, like, one of the most effective decks that we saw was when Sifka transformed into just straight blue-green consistent dot deck. Obviously, he was sideboarding against Wesco specifically, but just the ability to routinely present threats and enact the same game plan every game, I think is really powerful. And we did see a decent amount of games come down to mana issues and being able to be, you know, more solidly two color, like the deck that we saw Reed draft seems to yield its benefits in this format.
Yeah, I think that that is really the number one thing that when you ask a pro or somebody who just drafts a lot, what are your priorities during the draft? I think that the mana fixing is the first thing that comes out of their mouth. And the interesting part is that you will get different answers. Somebody like Reed was saying that he's really concerned. I mean, he was saying he was playing a two-color deck yesterday and that he still, you know, missed his mana, right? Mm. So even just the light splashes and stuff, you have to really kind of watch out for your mana. But then you get somebody like Craig Wesco who was like, diving in, right? And he just, I mean, he had, it was either 12 or 13 non-basics.
Yeah, I mean, it was like a cube draft game.
It looked like a cube draft where you're just like taking the land and figuring it all out later. And I mean, you can't quite push it that far, but there's definitely a contingent of pros that are like, hey, I can play five color in this format. I'm going to do that.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, I mean, I guess one is pretty rare, but 2, 3, 4, five color decks. And the other thing, you know, there's those synergies in those enemy colors, too. You know, we saw Wesco make an 11-11 token because he had, you know, a rotting mastodon with a bunch of counters on it. You know, toughness is the sort of black-green sub-theme.
Yeah, Kintree Invocation doing big work there for sure.
You're right, exactly. So, I mean, in addition to all the clans, you've got these kind of niche archetypes to discover, too. I mean, just a really rich format.
Right. All right, speaking of rich, he is sitting over at the news desk right now, awaiting to get you guys set up to watch some standards. Let's throw it over there, and when we come back to the booth, it's going to be your first look at the pro level of standard with Cons of Tarkir here from Hawaii. We'll see you guys in a bit.
All right, thank you so much to the guys, Zach Hill and Marshall Sutcliffe, bringing you all the limited action here at Pro Tour Cons of Tarkir. Now, we have a scoreboard for you. But the scoreboard, well, it's pretty much a random selection of the 3-0 players. In total, we have 50 or so players who will get to 3-0. The scoreboard reflects around about 20 of those. So we'll take a look. Here's just some of the 3-0 players for you, and I'll walk you through some of the other big names who are also at 3-0, but not on this unsorted leaderboard, if you like. Greg Orange, you see there, of the United States, he made a real splash last time around at Pro Tour M15. Tamás Nagy is a notable player from Hungary, one of their finest. Joel Kallifel is back on the PT after a fairly prolonged absence, hasn't been quite on the pro scene for the last 12 to 18 months. Stanislav Sivka, Pro Tour return to Ravnica champion with his eggs deck, of course. Will combo be a thing in standard? We'll find out this afternoon. Alexander Hayne of Canada is 3-0. Wonder how his morning went. We'll find out. Park Jun-young of South Korea. Then on the right-hand side of that leaderboard, you see Sean McLaren, Pro Tour champion from the past year. Christian Seibold, the Grand Prix Barcelona champion. Our reigning world champion, Shahar Shenhar, is 3-0. And you see Greg Cassini of France, 3-0. Let me tell you some other people who are also 3-0. Your number four player in the world, William Jensen, he's made a terrific start. He's 3-0. Marcus Ruggiero defeated Tom Martel in the pod match to go 3-0. Tony Portolan of Croatia, he's made it all the way to win his pod, and so has Johnny Magic. John Finkel aces his draft pod, goes into Constructed, part of the Pantheon. What have they got cooking for Standard? We'll find out this afternoon. Then on we go. Owen Turtenwald, he has aced his draft pod. Congratulations to him. Mike Sigrist, real grizzled veteran, as BDM says, he has got to 3-0. As I say, there are around about 50 players who will get to that perfect 3-0 record coming into Standard. We will expect 1, 2, or possibly 3 players to end the day with perfect 8-0 records. But for now, 3-0 is the best you can possibly do. Someone who's done that is Alexander Hayne, and right now he's over taking the load off his feet with Brian David Marshall.
Hi, everybody. I'm sitting here with Alexander Hayne, Pro Tour Avacyn Restored champion. I don't want to upset any of your pools that you guys have going about how often that gets stated. I know you guys have some friendly sandwich
yeah,
wagers on things. So you're off to a 3-0 start.
Yeah.
And this is really going to be damaging to your draft because you drafted all the platinum pros to see who would go worst. You did a reverse fantasy draft, and you picked yourself.
I did. Well, I figured if I was doing well, I wouldn't mind losing the fantasy draft.
Okay. And I mean, true or false, you just couldn't take the daggers if anyone else picked you.
True. Absolutely.
All right. Let's talk about booster draft for a minute. Been a lot of talk about cons of Tarkir, you know, how complex it is as a draft format. Is this a draft format that is exercising different muscles, or is it the same business as usual that we see in a draft format?
I think it's definitely different. Multicolored formats are different in general, but also a lot of the past recent limited formats have been very tempo-based. Like Theros was, you know, about curving out and having your tricks, and this format can often be a lot slower. It's a lot more grindy sometimes.
Okay. So walk us through what your draft table looked like and what you did in this draft and how it worked out for you.
So my draft table had Yuki Ichikawa, who I beat round one, Makihito Mihara, who I beat round two, and Chris Fennell, who I beat in the finals of the draft, as well as four people who I didn't recognize.
Yeah.
Ladies and
gentlemen, in case you were wondering what humble brags are, by the way... I'd like to introduce you to Alexander Hayne.
So the draft, I started with a pack with I started with a Raider Spoils,
okay,
which is a great card for a token archetype or especially Black-White Warriors, which I think is one of the best decks in the format.
Is that something you drafted a lot while you guys were in the house practicing?
I never really got to draft it. I'd taken a Raider Spoils before, but somebody else was taking the Black-White Warrior deck, and I just didn't get the cards. But this time I generally did, and I also picked up some lands along the way, so when I got some strong Mardu cards, I could splash them.
How do you feel about the sort of tension between like trying to be two color, three color, five color in this format?
In general, I don't like three color. I think you want to be like, you can be two colors, straight two colors with a splash, or if you're past that, you want to be like four or five colors. If you're taking all the lands highly, then you can afford to be a slower deck to come have your lands come into play tapped, and you can just cast all the most powerful spells, not just the ones in three colors.
How many, you know, if you're doing something like that, how many lands can you support in the non-basic category?
I've seen decks with like 10 non-basic lands in them. You know, it's sometimes more, and you can really support them because a lot of the cards in the format are playable. Even the bad ones are still reasonable. So.
Right. So you're black white splashing red.
Yeah.
What are the cards that make you want to splash red here?
So I had a Mardu Ascension.
A good one.
Ascendancy, sorry.
So, yeah.
And
yeah.
A Ankle Shanker, which
okay.
Both against Chris Fennell, I used them together, which is pretty absurd. I also had the Mardu 5-drop Rough Rider that
sure.
Stops creatures from blocking, which is really good. And I was the Morph, the Pony.
Pony Back Brigade. Sure.
Who,
BoJack Horseman himself.
he's great, and those were the cards I was splashing red for. The Morph is also, I really like splashing Morphs because when you don't draw the splash color, you can still play it as a 2/2 and often trade with their guys.
What does your mana look like for a deck like that?
So I had two mountains as well as my two lands, and I was playing 8/7.
Okay, so you had four red sources to support.
Yeah.
Two of them were
three cards and one morph card, yeah.
Okay, all right, awesome. So are we excited about going into standard? Do we feel confident?
A little nervous. We'll see how it goes, you know.
All right. Well, I'm gonna let you go get some sleeves, get everything sorted out, and get ready for standard. But
thanks.
In the meantime, 3-0 in booster draft for Alexander Hayne. This has been Brian David Marshall.
All right, thanks so much, BDM. Thanks very much to Alexander Hayne. Another guest coming your way in just a minute over in the comfortable chairs with Brian David Marshall. But first, looking through the results, combing through. Well, I'm going to say a few names, and if you hear the name of your best friend in Magic, this is not good. This is some of the 0-3s, really up against it. Not dead, round about 12-3-1 is the record needed for the top eight. Maybe 12-4 sneaks in, but from 0-3, desperate trouble. Chapman Sim, 0-3. Dmitry Butikov, one of the great Magic Online players, he has had a horrible draft morning, 0-3. Rasmus Bjorklund of Sweden, 0-3. Roberto Gonzalez, who was ninth at Pro Tour Gatecrash, 0-3. And also Michael Majors, one of the most consistent players on the tour. When he's going 0-3, it just shows you what a tough draft format this is. Michael Majors, 0-3. he's going to really struggle to make it, well, first of all, into day two. 4-4, remember, is what lets you come back. But on the other side of the coin, 3-0. Well, that's all the good news you want. And it's been a pretty good week for the man over with Brian David Marshall right now. Not only is he 3-0, his mum and dad are here, his girlfriend's in town this weekend, and he has been inducted into the Magic Pro Tour Hall of Fame. Here he is, Brian David Marshall and Paul Rietzl.
Thanks, Rich. I'm sitting here with Paul Rietzl. Paul, you were just inducted into the Hall of Fame, and you went 3-0 in a draft.
Yeah.
Which feels better?
Oh, the Hall of Fame. The Hall of Fame. But 3-0ing a draft is never a bad way to start a tournament, for sure.
What does that mean? You know, you've been doing this for a long time. You came back to the Pro Tour, actually, in Hawaii.
Right.
In 2009. And you've been here ever since. Like, how big is that 3-0 start heading into the constructed rounds for you?
Yeah, I mean, it's huge. You know, it's, in fact, you know, I think that the split format Pro Tour and getting to start with a draft and have a draft every day is one of the major things that I credit to my success, you know, in the later part of my career instead of the beginning, you know, that you know, it tests people in both disciplines. And oftentimes you play against, you know, players or you have people at your table in limited who are more constructed focused players and vice versa. And you can have a much bigger edge than if you're playing in a format where every single person has been preparing for this one format the entire time for the last, you know, X amount of months. But, you know, starting 3-0 is huge. You know, it takes a lot of the pressure off in one sense. But on the other hand, you know, I started 3-0 at the last Pro Tour and barely made day two. So,
okay.
You know, it's, you don't want to count the chickens before they hatch. And you know, every time that I've ever made a top eight, it's been because I had one of those really big, you know, 6-1-1, 7-1 records at day one where I felt like I was really well positioned. So I want to make sure that, you know, I can at least, you know, at least 3-2, but hopefully 4-1 or better from here and set myself up to make a run.
Tell me about what you were aiming for in draft as you sat down today for the first pod.
Well, I found that my experience in limited in general is just pretty different than most people. I think that when most people draft a format, the more they play it, the more they develop a color a preference for one shard, one guild, one color or another. I'm completely the opposite. I feel like the more that I draft a format and the more that I'm prepared, the more that I'm capable in drafting any of the different archetypes well. And so, you know, I think that this particular format lends itself really well to like old school, you know, bread style drafting, bombs, removal, evasion, advantage, and whatever D stands for. And so, you know, and
you don't want to know what D stands for.
And so, you know, with the fixing, obviously, you know, in your pick order, depending on the needs of your deck and also your read of the table. And you know, obviously with less experienced players, you can try to finesse fixing later than you might otherwise. So, you know, for me, like, and this bore out, we kept statistics on all of the decks that people play at the house. The best decks were just shard decks with really good mana fixing and a good curve and just like removal spells, you know, like old school limited. And the people who tried to get too cute with like the synergistic decks, oftentimes were getting stomped out. So I just wanted creatures, removal, and a curve. That's right. It.
And you don't care what set of colors you're getting that from. You'll take any clan. I was talking to William Jensen during your Hall of Fame induction dinner. And he talked about being comfortable in this draft format, the idea of like comfort, like that, and I think that's a little bit of what you're talking about, right?
Yep.
That you know all the paths you can take, and just whichever way the table steers you.
Right. Yeah. That's a big difference from, you know, me and some other previous limited formats. You know, like it's very rare that I just have a pick and I'm like, I have no idea what to take in the pack. You know, it's sometimes I know that two cards are pretty close and I'm not sure which one would increase my equity more. But I doubt that I'm making any picks that are just egregious and spewing off like into a horrendous deck. So yeah.
Your girlfriend, your parents were here
yep.
for your Hall of Fame induction ceremony. They're along the rail. They're watching you. Is that more stressful, or is that really, does that make it easier for you to play?
Like, oh, I love it. I love it. I mean, I've never been someone who gets really stressed out during Magic tournaments. Like, I don't know if you watched that last feature match. I mean, I have a blast, you know what I mean? Like, I just got really badly outplayed in that last match by David Williams. It doesn't bother me, and you know, sometimes people play better than you. It's Magic. And so to have people that I love and that I want to spend time with, you know, close, that I can access them for support and to spend time with them, you know, it's that makes it better and console me if things don't go well and hopefully celebrate if they do, so.
Excellent. And how are you feeling heading into Constructed? You feel?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think that modern Magic, specifically Standard, many of the decks are pretty close against one of another. It's infrequently that you see like the old, oh, I can't beat that deck, you know, because some of the cards are just so powerful, so objectively powerful that that most decks can put together a pretty coherent, proactive game plan. So, you know, I have a deck that I like. I think it's really well tuned. Do I think it's the best choice? I have no idea. You know what I mean? I have no idea, but we'll see what happens.
Yeah, we'll find out in probably about 20 minutes.
Right.
I'm going to let you go grab some food. I'm telling you right now, next Pro Tour, I want Pantheon blue paper coffee cups.
All right.
Just letting you know that right now, putting it out there.
We'll run it up the chain.
Okay. Yeah. For Paul Rietzl, Brian David Marshall, sending it back to the news desk.
All right, thanks so much to Brian David Marshall and the new Hall of Famer, Paul Rietzl. Terrific player, terrific human being. I had to say that because his dad's just off camera. So here's what we're going to do. We're in the lunch break, and right now the players are gearing up. They're finding the last cards for their decks, sleeving up, and also getting a bite to eat. But for us, doesn't stop. We had Randy come in yesterday, Randy Buehler, Hall of Fame, another one, and he told us all about Standard. What is the new Standard going to look like? What are the next five rounds going to look like? Why don't we find out in the Standard Overview with Randy Buehler. We'll see you for round four in a little bit. Hello, everyone. Rich Hagen here at the news desk on Thursday night, no less, with Hall of Fame Mr. Randy Buehler. And Randy, it's crystal ball time. We get on the eve of the Pro Tour to talk about Standard for tomorrow and moving forward in this brand new Khanzer Tarkir format. But first, never mind as a Hall of Famer, never mind as one of the great deck building minds in the history of the game. As a fan, how excited are you for Standard?
I have never been this excited about any constructed Pro Tour. Like the unveiling that's going to happen tomorrow, it's about to happen by the time we play this. I mean, no one knows what's going to happen. It might be that round four might be the most exciting round in the history of the Pro Tour.
Wow.
This rotation has got to be the most impactful Standard rotation that has ever been. Khanz has added all kinds of toys. It's a super deep set. You know, I were fully 25 cards I was thinking about that I could imagine being in the top five. Mm-hmm. And the way the rotation lines up with so many cards leaving and all of the decks that were dominating Standard basically don't work anymore, it's going to be awesome.
Well, why don't we take a look at what isn't in Standard anymore? What's gone?
Yeah, no, that's definitely where the story starts for Standard right now. No more Sphinx's Revelation, no more Supreme Verdict. So the reign of that sort of awesome Esper control deck is basically over. Even Flock is, you know, put the cherry on the top for that archetype. Maybe you can still play a control deck, but only maybe. It's not even clear there's any deck left after those cards leave. Pack Rat is gone. Nobody's going to lose the turn two Pack Rat anymore. That's kind of awesome. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, Night Vale Spectre, the fact that the hybrid cards rotated out means a lot of the devotion strategies that were so good last year, they don't work. Like, Mono Blue Devotion doesn't have anything with enough blue mana pips. Mono Black Devotion doesn't have anything with enough black mana pips. And Lifebane Zombie's not going to be stealing green creatures out of your hand anymore. So it's just like the gates have opened up. You could just get to have more fun now.
Which sounds awesome, but although they've gone, it isn't just Khanzer Tarkir that's in the format. So what's still around?
Yeah, I definitely think that, you know, the big players that are left over, you know, Thoughtseize was a huge player. I actually think it's a little bit weaker this year than it was last year, just because there'll be a lot more mid-range decks. But Goblin Rabble Master broke out. He's awesome and is to continue to be awesome. The big story, though, I mean, Caryatid and Courser. You know, we saw 28 copies of those cards in the top eight in Atlanta. You know, I don't think we're going to see quite as many here because obviously you've got all of Khanz to play with, but the by far the most defining cards on this Standard are the leftover green cards, Courser and Caryatid. I think that's just a big deal. Everybody knows Fetchlands came in. That makes Courser even a little bit better. Khanz didn't have as much sauce for the green decks as for the other colors, though. So, I mean, it's still super open and interesting. But, yeah, Courser is definitely a big player, probably the best card in Standard right now.
Every new format has its selection of new mechanics that become very important, but not always keyword mechanics. And you've chosen to highlight a keyword mechanic that's been around since the absolute dawn of the game.
Yeah, well, what did I just say the best cards in the format are, right?
Sylvan Caryatid,
you know, Courser of Kruphix. Those cards clog up the ground. It is hard to attack on the ground, so go to the air. You can fly over those. And, like, the assortment of flying creatures that are available right now, there's a lot of them. I mean, you've got leftovers like Herald of Torment, and Stormbreath Dragon is still a big deal. Hornet Queen is actually showing up in a bunch of different lists. Green Devotion can play that. And sometimes you're just like, well, my Monsters deck just, you know what, we get to that much mana sometimes. Here's a Hornet Queen. What are you going to do about all these guys? So I definitely think having the ability to take your offense to the air, to just fly over these ground stalls. And I mean, some of these cards are super aggressive, 3 and 4 mana cards as well. So I think flying is actually really important right now. I mean, that obviously the ability's been around forever, since the beginning. I'm not sure it's ever been better.
Awesome. All right, so we're going to get into a top, what, dozen or so cards? And this is where we get into proper speculation mode. But there's a lot of depth to Khan's Attack here, right?
Yeah, no, I thought I was going to do a top 10 list. I wound up doing a top 12 list with a couple of honorable mention slides.
Okay.
Like I said, I think it's actually really hard to figure out what's, you know, the top one, the top five cards from Khan's, because it's such a deep set. So, I mean, you look at cards that didn't make the cut from what wound up being a top 12, you know, End Hostilities is going to show up. Right, that's the best Wrath of God that's in the format right
yes.
now.
So yep.
it's gonna show up if anybody can play blue-white control. You know, I'm sure some people will try it. And then you get a card like Jeskai's Ascendancy. Like, Jeskai's Ascendancy is clearly gonna be a big player in some of the older formats. I don't know if it's good enough to make the cut in Standard or not. I think a lot of people are, it's one of the cards people are curious about. You know, let's find out. Can you actually run Jeskai's Ascendancy in Standard? You know, and here I've got, I don't even have it in the top 12 because that's an open question right now, so.
Yeah, it has to be one of those cards that if you don't want to be in with 200 other people on some kind of base caryatid courser plan, right. that this is a card that you could potentially pin your hopes on.
Yeah, you could actually say that caryatid is the card that's going to get the most played, because you're playing caryatid in the Jeskai's Ascendancy.
Yeah, okay, sure.
So,
yeah.
You know, I've been wondering how many coursers or Kruphix are going to be in the top 8. The caryatids may actually be the most played card in the top 8 if Ascendancy's any good. But I mean, we don't know. We'll find out. We'll find out if Ascendancy is actually good enough to play or not.
Yeah.
Right now, I've got it at honorable mention. I've got it at maybe status.
Yeah. I personally, I hope that goes up because I like me a little bit of combo action. Red hot combo in the top 8. I'd have one of them in there. Yeah. I don't want 6, but a Jeskai Ascendancy deck in the top 8 could be kind of fun. What else we got? Honorable mentions.
Yeah, no, there's a bunch of creatures here. You know, Seeker of the Way can be very good in a sort of aggressive Jeskai deck. You know, Anafenza can come out and do lots of things. You know, Wingmate Rock is just such insane value for that card, and it's only in one color. So, I mean, I definitely think that there's a lot of Necropolis Fiend can show up in the Delve deck. Just such a deep set and such a wide open format. So, all kinds of new toys to play with.
Awesome stuff. Come on then, give us the top dozen, count right. them down, and we'll see how we go. Good luck
yeah.
with this.
Yeah, oh yeah, clearly out on a lot of limbs here, very skinny
Absolutely.
Limbs. I've got Bloodsoaked Champion 12. I think that Bloodsoaked Champion is incredibly powerful. You know, the fact that it's a 1-mana 2/1 that just keeps coming back with that raid trigger. You know, this is as good as a one drop can be. The only reason I have it all the way down at 12 is that, you know what? It gets blocked by Courser, it gets blocked by Caryatid. I don't know how good the aggro decks are actually going to be. I think that we're going to see a format which is really, really mid-rangey mm-hmm. and kind of grindy. And, you know, Bloodsoaked is okay in a grind battle, but if there's just a million 2/4s and 0/3s blocking it, you know, this is really how good Bloodsoaked Champion is comes down to how good, you know, mono black aggro, you know, ribbied red black aggro. If you want 1-mana 2-power guys, you know, a lot of us will call them jackal pups. Really sort of the first really right. good 1-mana 2-power guy. You can get like 20 jackal pups in a deck these days. And it's like, which jackal pups do you want to play with? Well, this is probably the best one, but we'll find out how good the archetype actually is.
Yeah, I guess the thing with the champion is that if it's getting blocked by a caryatid turn after turn,
yep.
then, well, that's kind of okay because that means the caryatid isn't blocking something else yep. of yours, and it's just having one more, and once you get two of those going.
Profitably.
Of course, yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. I don't know. That. All right, 11. Now, this is a card I can get behind. Savage Knuckleblade.
Absolutely. Savage Knuckleblade. It's this guy's 3-mana 4/4 with 3 different positive abilities. This guy is nuts. It's another one where I've got him at 11th because I don't know if there's the right deck. You know, is Teemer really the clan that's going to show up?
Mm.
You know, you see a lot of people playing a lot of different base green decks. I don't know if there's enough blue cards to pull you into Teemer. If it is, by the way, the card that this guy will also carry into high numbers is Stubborn Denial.
Like, oh, the counter spell.
Suddenly, one mana counter your planeswalker. Mm. One mana, it's one mana negate, essentially, if you have the Ferocious. Like, negate has seen lots of play. So, you know, Savage Knuckleblade, it's one of those nice, like, it's a Brian Kibler card, right? It can be down, it can play defense, you know, it can do all kinds of different things, so.
If you add up the mana symbols on that card, in ignoring the casting cost itself, you have 7. 2 and a green, 2 and a blue, red. So there's quite a lot of combinations there. When do you see this being played? Is this just an automatic 4-4 on turn 3 without the ability to return it, without the ability to give it haste? Are people going to just play it on 3, or are people going to be looking to build decks in a way that lets them play something else on 3, and this is a 4-4 haste on 4?
I think that if this is, it's a totally reasonable turn 3 play. If your hand says this is your 3 drop, you just run it out. Make them answer it, right? Maybe you get to untap. Maybe you get an attack with it. That's awesome. You know, if you have a different turn 3 play, like maybe you have a Courser in your hand and you're flanking, you've got the red mana to give it haste and attack on turn 4, maybe you slow roll it because you have a different 3 drop, but you don't need to wait to have the abilities turned on for this card to be good. If that's just the thing that you're playing on turn 3, it's totally fine to you know, you don't have to leave the shields up. The shields in particular, the return shield, the 3 mana to bring it back to your hand, that's really the kind of thing that kicks in the long game. Yeah. That's how the deck helps you win. If you get into some kind of stall, some sort of mid-range kind of grindy game, this guy gives you that sort of long-term advantage, can give you that inevitability. But I mean, plan A is just do the savage part, right?
Yeah.
Just run him out there and start turning him sideways.
Yeah, tried at a number of different development costs, and they're all really good. Now, at 10, this is the first of our land cycle that we're going to highlight here. How important, Randy, is mana base and land mix and what people choose to play going to be in determining the destiny of this Pro Tour?
Yeah, it's huge. I'm not sure there have been this many options for lands in Standard. I mean, you've got the tri-lands. You can gain life from your lands if you want to. And one of the weird tensions that's going to happen is, do you want your lands to be slow or painful? Right? You can play, comes into play tap lands like the tri-lands and the scry-lands where, okay, it came into play tapped, or you can go to the fetch land, pain land, you know, that side of things where your land can be painful but available right away. So just having all of those options, that's one of the reasons the format is as wide open as it is. And, you know, the tri-lands, I do think they're going to show up in here and there. They're going to show up. They're going to let you turn on all of those sort of three-color gold goodies that Khans has brought to play. You know, probably not the best lands in the set, not the best lands in Standard, but sort of an important piece.
And are they going to be things that we see deck lists with one of this one of the other in a deck list, as opposed to 4 Nomad Outpost up front kind of thing?
Yeah, you should look for mana bases. They're going to be things like, okay, I've got, you know, 4 fetch lands, 2 of this basic, 2 of that basic, you know, 3 pain lands, 2 of this scry land, 2 of that scry land. Like, you can have a lot of, the building the mana bases in this format is tricky because there's so many different options, and it really is, you know, how much pain can you afford to take? Part of that is a function of your deck. Part of that is also a function of the field that you expect to show up. You know, are people going to show up with Bloodsoak Champions? You know, you don't want to take that much pain from your land if people are attacking you right away with Bloodsoak Champions. But, you know, if people are maybe digging through time, then whatever, all day.
Tri-lands at 10. In we go to number 9, please. And it is, Dig Through Time. Yeah.
If there's a control deck, it's because of this card. You know, this card, I mean, it's not Sphinx's Revelation, but it is good enough that you're willing to play bad blue cards to get to draw cards with this thing.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, kind of.
I mean, Sphinx's Revelation is so ridiculous that it almost didn't matter what the rest of the blue cards were. You're going to you get to draw so many of them with Sphinx's Revelation.
That's a perfectly reasonable card. What are you talking about?
Look, I'm happy to draw cards and gain life, but I mean, this is the quote-unquote replacement. It's definitely plays a very similar role. It gives you that late-game card advantage and the selectivity. I mean, drawing 2 of 7, that's a lot of selection. I know people are super excited about the Treasure Cruise, being able to just draw 3, especially in some of the Eternal formats. Mm. You know, this effect is significantly better than draw 3 cards. I mean, you look at this, it's how do you parse it, right? It's all this mana. Look at 7, keep 2. Like, this is better than draw 3 cards. I'd much rather look at 7 and choose 2 than just draw 3 blind. So it's a very powerful effect. You know, once the control deck gets to the point where it can start casting these, it's gonna win. You know, not quite as quickly or as, you know, rock solid, impossible to come back from as a Sphinx's Revelation, but playing a similar role.
All right, look forward to getting those then. Dig through time for me, thank you. Number eight, it's Crater's Claws, X with upside.
Yeah, no, this makes the cut. The fact that that plus two is one of the better abilities that's been tacked onto one of these X spells. And the thing is, there's so many four power creatures that it's turned on a lot. Not only can you turn it on in sort of any random, you know, teamer, it's kind of the ferocious teamer mechanic, but the other place I think you'll see this, and probably the place it'll show up even more, is in a green devotion list where, you know, you dump your hand with thanks to Nykthos,
yeah.
And then you're looking for something to do with all that Nykthos mana now. Ooh. That Nykthos is generating, you know, 10, 12, maybe 20 mana, just splash a little red in your green devotion list. So give you something to do with all that Nykthos
mana.
Yeah,
I can think if I had 20 mana spare plus a red, I could add up to something
that will
quite...
That was going to happen. Somebody is going to get Crater's Claws out from 20 by Green Devotion deck.
It's almost worth having that happen to you to be able to tell the story that happened to you, especially if it's like in game two and you win the match anyway.
Sure.
All right. At number seven, we have Sidisi Brood Tyrant.
Yeah, the Delve decks are super powerful. You know, Sidisi, the fact that Sidisi mills gets these creatures into play, you start turning on things like Satyr Wayfinder, right? You've seen these green-black graveyard decks running around Standard for a little while. I can use Wayfinder, I can commune with the gods, I can sort of play these two-mana cards that kind of incidentally put things into my graveyard and, you know, kind of get me the card that I need to keep going. What if Sidisi's in play as you're Satyr Wayfindering and communing with the gods and sort of building up your graveyard to do these graveyard things? Suddenly you're just also playing up getting a bunch of zombies. Pretty powerful effect. Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that, you know, where she ultimately winds up in the cons list is going to come down to how good that Sultai Delve deck actually is. But right. I think it's good. I think it's good. I think it's definitely good enough to show up. It's good enough to make it to Sunday. We'll find out.
Absolutely. All right. We are into our top six here in our prediction for the Standard World coming your way. Fetchland Cycle. What lovely, lovely cards.
Oh, yeah. Great cards. It'd be a little boring to put them much higher on the list. And the interesting thing about the fetch lands, I think they're not actually as important to Standard as they are to, say, Modern.
Okay.
Because there's so many other options, mm-hmm. and you don't have shock lands to go get with them. So, like, you're either getting a mountain or you're getting a swamp. Like, you're only getting basic lands with them.
Right.
So they're still good. I mean, they're still definitely one of the options. And if you want your mana, if you're willing to take pain in order to have your lands come into play untapped, you know, this is one of the land cycles you absolutely want. They're absolutely crucial to Standard. But it's not like they're going to dominate Standard, all the mana bases, the way they do in Modern. You know who they are good with, though?
Go on.
Corsair of Crucifix.
Yes.
Like, mono-green lists will play fetch lands because the synergy with Corsair is so good. Like, instead of paying a life to get a land, what if you gained a life to get a land?
Woohoo!
Yeah, it's better. Oh, and the ability to reshuffle while Corsair's in play. I mean, I could have inched them up a little bit, because you know they're going to come up, and you know they're good in the Corsair decks. The ability to reshuffle when you don't like the card that's on top is super powerful, and the life gain is also nice.
We've had Trilands, we've had Dig Through Time, Crater's Claws, we've had the fetch lands. People want big, powerful, meaty creatures, Randy. And because it's the Pro Tour, they want efficiency too. Give it to them.
How about Siege Rhino?
Done.
Yeah, how about it? 4/5 for 4, drain 3 life. Oh, by the way, trample. Yeah, this is just kind of everything that you want to be doing with sort of this medium, the large creature, right? I mean, I want to call him medium, but he's not medium, he's huge. It's just the mana cost is the mid-rangey part.
Yes, that's the only bit that isn't actually
the part
huge.
That's medium-sized, yeah, the 4 mana. So, I mean, this is definitely going to going to bring decks into the field. I think people are going to be playing white and black and green mana. I mean, it sort of becomes like, which creatures are you playing? Which colors do you want to add into your Corsair Caryatid deck? Well, Siege Rhino is the reason to go into white, basically.
The one thing that doesn't do is protect itself. Like most creatures, it sits there doing its thing, and if you have an answer, you have an answer. In Khans, there have been a lot of very powerful answers printed for creatures. Let's take a look at one of them now at number 4.
Yeah, Murderous Cut is super efficient. I mean, you say, what, you know, we want a good rate. We want efficiency. How about kill that for 1 mana? This is going to show up for all the time that it's Standard legal. It's good enough to start showing up in older formats as well. This is just a super efficient card. And it's not like you don't need to be doing anything special to get cards into your graveyard. You just randomly play a game of Magic, you're going to wind up with some cards in your graveyard, especially if you've got a fetch land-based mana base. So Murderous Cut usually only costs 1. That's the first one in particular is only going to cost 1. You have to make sure not to put too many Delve cards in your list. Like, he's not best friends with Dig Through Time, for example.
Sure.
But very efficient card. Does kill Siege Rhino, but whatever. You just run the Siege Rhino. It's like the Savage Knuckleblade story we were talking about. Just play it. Force them to answer it. You know, they either spend one of their premium removal spells answering your big creature, or you get to attack them. Anyway, that's definitely a lot of what you're going to see this weekend, I think, is big monsters and then answers to those big monsters and games that kind of go a while that for that reason.
Okay, now traditionally, Planeswalkers have always been a big part of constructed formats and limited too. Here's our number three. It is a Planeswalker, Sarkhan the Dragonspeaker.
Yeah, he's in such a good spot in this format. The fact that he can come down and fly over anything that happens to be coming up the ground and deal four damage, it matches up super well against Elspeth in particular. Like right. All those Elspeths that have been, you know, blowing up your big creatures and annoying you for the last, you know, the last however long in Standard, just kill them with Sarkhan. No problem. Attack, go to the air, and she can't do anything about him. Like, she just can't defend herself from Sarkhan. And Sarkhan's pretty good at killing players, too.
Yes.
I mean, in a similar spot to Stormbreath Dragon.
Okay.
I mean, I think that, you know, he does live on a very similar spot. Most of the decks that have had Stormbreath Dragons, I think you're going to wind up wanting a mix. Like, Stormbreath Dragons Pro White is still good, but Sarkhan's also good. Like, maybe it's a couple Sarkhans and then go to Stormbreaths, since you can't play multiple Sarkhans at the same time. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, going to be a player. You know, anybody who's got the ability to cast Sarkhan will want to.
All right, that's number three. What is number two? Mantis Rider.
Yeah, I've got Mantis Rider him. The Jeskai decks, when you play Mantis Rider on turn three, that Jeskai deck is so good. I mean, the only problem with the archetype is that when you don't actually have the Mantis Rider, maybe your deck's a little clunky, maybe your deck's a little fragile.
Uh-huh.
You know, you start trying to stitch things together, but Mantis Rider is so good that it's got people playing sort of aggressive Jeskai decks single-handedly all by itself. Three mana, three power, flying, haste, vigilance. Every word on that card matters, and every word on that card is just, yeah, efficient.
Is Jeskai where you see aggro being if there is a sort of a swell towards aggro at the PT this weekend?
Well, there's kind of like the most aggressive decks will be the sort of blood-soaked champion, you know, the Jackal Pups decks.
Right.
Whether that's red with like Rabble Master at the top of a curve of aggressive red weenies, or whether it's black. I mean, Rabble Master,
very
shows, right? He goes on the top of the curve.
Yeah.
For that deck. So, I mean, I think you can play red aggro, you can play black aggro, and you can go to Jeskai. Jeskai's kind of the new aggro deck, I guess you will. And it is, you can call it tempo. I don't know what tempo means in that context. It's a beatdown deck. It's just like, I'm willing to pay a little bit extra mana to get my stuff to the air and fly over your blockers.
Flying could really matter. We are down to number one. What have you chosen for the number one potential card for Standard?
Yeah. It's hard to pick a number one in a set this deep,
yes.
But I decided to go with a sexy one. Butcher of the Horde. This guy is gigantic. 5/4 flying for four. Like, I'm sold.
Can I just?
I'm in.
I need to check with you just to back up a minute.
Okay.
The sexy one. You're talking in gameplay mechanics, because I would hate to think that was a flavor reference there.
Correct.
Good like, to know.
5/4 flying. Sack a creature to gain those abilities. Here's the thing that, when I picture Butcher the Horde and I get excited about having the opportunity to play with this guy, I usually in my head have played Goblin Rabble Master on turn three. Like,
right.
You play Goblin Rabble Master, I mean, one of the best leftover cards in Standard from my list, right? You play Goblin Rabble Master on turn three, you know, maybe your token suicides, maybe your token, if you have the token left over, suddenly you get to give this guy haste on turn four, and then if you want to, you make another token, you can give him lifelink or vigilance. Like, those abilities get turned on. There's enough cards that throw out random tokens, Rabble Master being the best of them, that like that second ability may look like, well, no, I'm not going to sack my creatures for this. No, you're going to sack your goblin that had to attack into a courser anyway. Absolutely. The other thing you get with the Butcher is you get to play with Thoughtseize. Like, you get to play with Thoughtseize,
right.
You get to play with Goblin Rabble Master, and you get to fly over with 5/4 flying.
Can't say fairer than that. Randy Buehler, the Hall of Fame. We're gearing up for Standard. Will Butcher of the Horde be number one? Well, we are about to find out, because lunchtime's nearly over, and that means Standard time is just around the corner. And round the corner, oh, it's me. Hello, everyone. Welcome over there. we've got a select list of 3-0 players. Why don't I give you a better view of it? Why don't we take a look at our select leaderboard here as we head out of lunchtime and into standard. Now, those 20 names, there's another 25, 30 names who are also drafted perfect records 3-0. But these are 20 of the best who will be going at it. Where do we begin? Joel Calafell of Spain. He led Worlds 1 year, Grand Prix champion 2009. Patrick Chapin, of course, a Pro Tour winner in the last year. Stanislav Sifka, a modern Pro Tour champion in 2012 in Seattle. Alexander Hain, another Pro Tour champion from Avacyn Resort, defeated Gaudenis Vidugiris in the final of that one. South Korea's Park Jung-yung, grumpy stalwart of the last couple of years. Sean McLaren, in the last year, a Pro Tour champion. Tamás Nagy has represented Hungary 4 times at the World Magic Cup. Christian Seibold, he's your champion from Grand Prix Barcelona with the Grafensteiner brothers earlier in 2014. What about Shahar Shenhar? He's gone a little bit quiet since winning the World Championship, but he remains your world champion until Nice, when we will see what happens with Shahar Shenhar. Can he go up against 23 other of the finest players on earth in Nice in what an astonishing week that's going to be, not just the World Championship, but of course the World Magic Cup too. Mike Sigrist, he is your Grand Prix Washington DC champion from 2014. So he's on our 20 to watch list of the 3-0s. Let's continue down that list for you and look at the names that you want to support as we head into the standard rounds. Yoshihiko Ikawa of Japan. Days are kind of gone now where you would naturally expect Shuhei Nakamura, Kenji Samura, Tomohiro Saito to be your 3-0s. And now this is the new breed of Japanese player, although just a couple below him, there is Yuya Watanabe, the twice player of the year. He has made it to 3-0, as has Owen Turtenwell, the 2011 player of the year. Another Pro Tour champion, even Flock, remember our King of the Hill table. If you keep winning, you keep staying in the feature match area. Flock, of course, as the last champion, he got to start the day in the feature match area. He hasn't been out on the main floor yet. 3-0 his draft pod. He will be back there in our 4 feature tables that are coming right up. You've not missed a single turn. Players are just on having a little bit of a bio break in the feature match area, so you're missing nothing right now. Daniel Royd from England, 3-0. Teammate Matt Light went 2-1. And then 2 Hall of Famers, indeed 3 Hall of Famers in the next 4. Finkel, Jensen, Rietzl, all 3-0. Are they going to collide sometime in the next couple of hours here at Pro Tour Kanza Tarkir? Croatia's Tony Portalan, he will be representing Croatia yet again on team play in Nice at the end of the year. And Suhan Yoon from Japan is also 3-0. So as I say, there's around about 45 to 50 players with a perfect record. As the afternoon wears on, we'll narrow it down to a pure leaderboard round about round 6. And we guess 1, 2, maybe 3 players will get to a perfect 8-0 record. But we're ready for round 4. How about this lot? Christian Calcano will face Luis Scott Vargas, both at 2-1. At 3-0, Hall of Famer William Jensen faces Sean McLaren of Canada, Pro Tour champion against Hall of Famer. Park Jung-yung of South Korea faces Evan Flock at the King of the Hill table. But we begin our constructed rounds here at Kanza of Tarkir with Ben Stark against Raf Levy. Standard time. Rock and roll.